All right, I'd like to call to order the August 19, 2013, regular meeting of the Board of Education. We convened at 7 p.m. Quorum has been established. We have met in closed session, and ready to pledge allegiance?
Yes.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item is approval of minutes of the July 15, 2013 business meeting and the July 15, 2013 closed meeting. Do I have a motion for approve?
So moved.
A second.
Okay, let's vote.
Terry Pavasich.
Aye.
Mike Davenport.
Aye.
Julie Beckman.
Abstain.
Deb Boyle.
Aye.
Keith Mattoon.
Aye.
Rick Pavanato.
Aye. Okay. Next, we go on to our reception of visitors. This meeting agenda includes two opportunities for comments. The first reception of visitors is intended for audience members to address the board about any agenda item on which the board will vote tonight. Are there any visitors that would like to comment? Okay. Next, we'll go on to recommendations and reports of the superintendent. Only thing on the agenda is the Freedom Information Acts.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Pavanato. There will be a couple of items on the to discuss at our next month's meeting, but I was hoping that all the board members would be in attendance at that meeting for that discussion. We did have two Freedom of Information requests this past month. One was fulfilled in part and denied in part, and the second was fulfilled.
Okay. We'll go on to the consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the personnel report? Each one separate or all together?
All together.
All together.
We approve them all together. It's fine to alliterate the reports that are in that consent
okay.
agenda.
Well, go for, do I have a motion for the consent agenda that includes the personnel report, the financial report, and the approval of 2013-2014 grant programs?
So moved.
Oh. Sorry.
Go ahead, Julie.
Let's do it.
I'll second it.
Seconded. Let's vote.
Julie Beckman.
Aye.
Terry Pavasich.
Aye.
Deb Boyle.
Aye.
Mike Davenport.
Aye.
Keith Mattoon.
Aye.
Rick Pavanato.
Aye. All right. Next, the tentative budget has been on display for 30 days. I declare as vice president, the public hearing is open. Are there anybody who'd like to make comments?
Actually, if you could, I'd like to make a presentation and then
okay.
open it for anybody to make comments. Because I have this up here. You won't
presentation is going to be in the five-year projection, correct, Mr. Stalen?
It'll be the five-year. I start with the tentative budget, and actually, I'm going to roll right into the tentative budget, and then
okay.
Have at that point maybe an opportunity for anybody here from the community to respond if they want to. What I started doing today was just to pull the graphs that were in your written narrative together, but then as I did it, I thought I would just make it easier in case there were any individuals here who didn't have it. So you probably do need to direct your vision up to the front here because it's not going to be exactly in the same format that you have in your packet.
What are you saying?
Tonight I'm going to start with the highlight of the tentative 2013-14 budget that was presented last month and approved for release to the community at that point. Then I'm going to roll right into the five-year forecast because it is based on that budget. Then we're going to give the board at that time an opportunity. You need to go, if you wouldn't mind at that point, going to the open budget hearing where you can hear comments from community members and then close that, and then we can ask you to vote. And even if it says votes on tentative budget, at that point it would be our voting on our permanent budget. At this point, it's still tentative. The highlights are that it's balanced. Operating expenditures and the transfers, and I'll get to that in a little bit, are equal to the operating revenues. So these are highlights. The reserves remain stable around 5.6% of the 2013-14 revenues. And in calendar days, that's about 21 days of operations. In school days, if you just do it based on 176 school days, it's around 10 school days. So it's not a huge reserve that we maintain. We do defer revenue until the next fiscal year, so we are able to operate a little more well than that would imply. But we do not maintain a high reserve, and that's by design. The budget includes Common Core and Avid initiatives that we've added this year, part of our strategic plan. The pension crisis and state cash flow issues are still unresolved. They are not directly reflected in the budget, other than there's a reduction in the state aid this year, which is really unusual. But there's nothing padded in the budget for a possible pushdown. We don't expect the states to resolve their issues and push something back down to us in this fiscal year. And that's an important part of this budget. We don't expect any further harm, if you will, to our budget by the resolution of the pension crisis. But we continue to implement our stabilization strategies. Number one, keep the budget in place. Really, the second thing is to continue aggressively address major capital outlay items and knock off as many of those off the list as we can. This is kind of a pinnacle for us, $1.8 million. Other than we added at the last minute last year, we added an $800,000 project that we took out of reserves. But for our normal allocation, it's $1.8 million, which is a high. Our normal reserve or normal allocation is about $1.5 million. And we continue to pay down outstanding debt obligations. These are all things we think strengthen us financially. So we are ready to do whatever and accommodate whatever happens when the state pushes its pension resolution down to us. The fund balances, this is the exhibit you would see in your report and was presented at last month. Balanced budget, the lighter green, revenues of $82.3 million and the expenditures of $80.2 million, plus the transfers out of the operating funds of about $2.1 million, which are to the immediate right of the red balance there, are total each other, and they're in balance. And so I'm very, very pleased, I guess, and proud that we're at this state in our operations to be able to do that. Overview for the revenues, total revenue growth expected to be 2.8%. This fiscal year of 2013-14 is directly tied to the 2011 CPIU, calendar CPIU cost of living factor of 3%. Taxes, we are estimating to go up 3.4%. 3% is the CPIU limit for a cost of living increase, and then 0.4 for new property added. Other local sources on a combined basis are actually down about $88,000 or about 2%. And part of that, the biggest piece of that actually is the TIF that's expired in Bolingbrook, where we're getting about $100,000, $110,000 a year is the biggest piece. Pretty much everything else in local sources overall is flat. We did not increase fees this year. State sources are up 8%, largely because of expenditures last year that we're getting reimbursed this year for special ed purposes. And then federal sources are down due to sequestration, where they've actually reduced some of our grants. Now, the good news is that in the interim, we've now heard that we may get some more allocations, which will help us offset some of that. So there's a positive note, but it has not been incorporated into the budget yet. It's not been formalized. Here it is in the graph that you see, or the exhibit that you see in your report. 2.8% increase in overall. And the small notation at the bottom there, which is contingency, we have an overall contingency in our operating funds of about $1 million, which is just a little over 1%. Tentative budget expenditures, salary and benefits combined are up 2.65% in total. Salaries for existing staff in total went up 2.2%. The FTE that we added for our new initiatives for the Avid and the Common Core were an additional cost of about 0.3%. And if you look at the exhibit in a minute, you'll see that our total salaries went up 2.5%. That's the total of those two lines, 2.2 and 0.3. The benefits are up 3.5%. Medical and dental actually increasing less than 2.5%, way below trend, continues to be below trend. And we have a fairly significant reserve in that area, which helps us if we do have any problems going into the future. IMRF budgeted, we put up, increased that account 6.3%. They have been increasing the rate over the last few years, in part because their total investment portfolio is not kept up with, and a lot of their long-term investments have been rolling off, so their investment yield is dropping, and that's part of the formula that they pushed down to district-paid benefits. So that's the biggest factor in the total benefits going up 3.5%. Tentative budget expenditures, purchase services continuing on 5.5% in total. Food, service, and bus contracts are tied to CPIU, 3%. But we did increase in the operations and maintenance fund outside service contract budgets, and that's what's really pushed some of that up for that whole area to go up by purchase services by 5.5%. Supplies are up just slightly at 0.4%. There were some savings in utilities that were helping to offset some other costs in that area. That's why the yield is, the net is 0.4. Capital outlay up 9.5%, and again in the O&M fund, that fund alone has a 9.9% increase. That's where most of the capital outlay is found, and we're pushing that up to try and just knock off some projects and keep ourselves in a strong position financially. Other account, which is primarily professional development, is up 13.9%. Mm. Good part of that is tied to our initiatives with Common Core and Avid. Tuition overall, we see that dropping 6.8%, and it's largely just the kids in the pipeline, and that we have a fewer number of kids expected to be out of district next year. There it is again in the chart. Again, 2.6% total expenditures compared to last year's actual, and the contingency is balanced the same at $1 million outside of that. Tentative budget for non-operating funds, the excess operating revenues over operating expenditures of $2.1 million are being transferred to the debt service fund to help pay down the long-term debt obligations, make about 20% of our long-term debt outstanding being paid by operating funds, and I think that's very unique, and it's a strength of our district right now. If we did have a large calamity, large problem, we do have bonding capacity without going referendum, which would cover a good portion of that. But obviously we prefer not to do that because we don't want to increase our tax rate. We'd rather keep it like we have it right now. There it is in chart form, and you can see the debt service line item on top there. Transfers in of $2,085,000. Are tied to, on the bottom, paid from operating funds, the maturities, and that lower section are just the principal portion, don't include the interest portion, and that's the difference between the $2,085,000 and the $1.5 million in principal on the bottom. So we're continuing to do a good job there with that. And I'll address that a little bit in the five-year forecast. And that comes up next. The tentative budget is the base year for our five-year forecast. So we're using the tentative budget as year one, and then we're forecasting 4 years out from that. And that's how these, and why these are two items are tied together. So I'm gonna start covering that part right now. The five-year forecast does reflect our ability to maintain a stable profile. However, you know, what every good economist will do is, you know, give you the accept. All the assumptions, parameters, and key variables need to be understood, and the key ones, obviously, are CPIU, the total salaries and benefit relationship with CPIU, the enrollment forecast, and then the future threats and concerns, which I've noted in the narrative, but I'll cover a little bit in a few minutes. This is the top section of the forecast. In the past, I've never wanted to break these three pieces apart because I've always wanted them to be seen together so people couldn't misunderstand what parameters are part of that. But I number one, because it won't all fit on a PowerPoint slide very easily, but also because I think we can talk about it in three segments. So I'm going to take the five-year projection and break it into the three key areas, and I've added that bottom color key just to help us keep in mind what where those numbers come from. The green areas are known actual amounts, historical amounts that we can verify. The orange background with the white lettering is the average CPIU, and there's a good number of things that are tied to that. And I'll explain that in a minute. And then the yellow background projected are just simple projections, don't have that much of an impact, may have no impact on the forecast, but they're just noting what's coming out of it. Or the yellow with the red, I'm sorry, the orange lettering is projected with high impact. I'm going to talk about those in a minute. If you look on the right-hand side, under the expenditure parameters, you see the column net change. Most of those are not driving the forecast. They're really showing us the results of changes in the forecast. So the average revenue stream of 2.1% is simply taking and calculating what the average revenue stream is for the 5 years of the forecast. The 7.5% medical benefit increase, that actually is a driver in this one, where if you change that number, increase it, it will increase our expenditures. If we reduce that percentage, it'll reduce them. 7.5, I think, is very conservative in a positive way, in that I don't think we'll incur that. We have enough reserve in that area that we could probably absorb some increases. It would take a tremendous increase for us to have to go above 7.5% on average over the next 4 or 5 years. And then the next four lines are FTE changes in FY 2014-15 and then through 2017-18. Those are just results of what our FTE total cost are expected to be because of changes in our enrollment. And so you can see we actually have another year, and I'll get to it in a minute, but we see we have another year of enrollment dropping, and then it starts to push back on us a little bit, and that does factor into the long-term projection. So we will be looking closely at enrollment to see if it tracks in alignment with the study. If we go at this is the CPIU. This was in the narrative. It's a last 10-year actual, and the orange columns and the light blue columns to the right are what we're using for the projection. The two longer horizontal bars there are the 10-year average and then the 5-year average. And if you look at 2008, you can see that was the crash year for the recession. I still think of it as an anomaly, but you have to also consider that the 4.1 was an anomaly too. It's rare that we get that high. Right. And so we just kind of use the midpoint of 2.1%. There are economists that are saying it'll be higher than that. There are some economists that'll say that's maybe 2% is the floor for the next 3 or 4 years, that the economy is recovering, but I just used 2.1%. So that's an important driver because it has a lot to do with our forecast. 84% of our revenues are tied to CPIU, primarily through the property tax extension or Patella tax cap limits. And the increases are limited to inflation and any new property tax added to tax roll. You've heard me echo that to you dozens of times as each year, if you've been here a dozen of times, as we issue our levy. About 74% of our expenditures, though, are also currently tied directly to CPIU. Collective bargaining agreements and even informal agreements or just year-to-year agreements are basically very much tied to that. They're all intertwined. Transportation contract is tied to CPIU, the food service contract increases are tied to CPIU, and even departmental supply budgets, what we call departmental allocations to our buildings, are tied to CPIU. So in essence, about 74% of our expenditures are tied to that, and we work hard to make sure that we keep those tied to it because of the impact of CPI on our revenue stream. This chart is in your packet in this or in the online, and it just reflects how there is a correlation, because a lot of the yellow line is the total compensation, I mean the total salary and benefits historically. If you were to take the year-end summary that the district is shown it in July and add these salaries and benefits together, this is the increases you would see from year to year. And the green is the revenue stream from year to year for that same period of time. And because there's collective bargaining agreements that are established based on estimated amounts, we don't hit it every year. But in general, you can see there is correlation, and we do work hard to keep that correlation. Salary and benefits are, you know, a big part of our expenditures, and so it's very important that we have that correlation. The five, well, the key annual variables, biggest thing here is enrollment, obviously, that's in the going across there. We are assuming that the general ed instruction ratio of students to teacher of 21.8 will stay the same. And you can see, though, in the last couple of years for the top line, the projected enrollment using Caserta, it's going to jump up to us a little bit, and that's going to put pressure on the projection, and you'll see it in the total numbers when we look at the expenditure side. Another factor, if you look at the, not the bottom line, but the second to last, the major capital outlay, the regular allocation last year in green, there was $1.7 million. We also added an $800,000 project at the end of, just at the very end of the year, out of concern that we would have bigger problems if we didn't take care of it last year. That was the piping at North Campus. But the normal allocation was $1.7 million, and this year we've increased it to $1.8 million, and we're still able to keep a balanced budget. And then the forecast, though, is our normal allocation is $1.5 million, and that's what's in there. And so when we look at the forecast, you'll see for the next couple of years we have some surpluses, but this is where we would, absent any other areas like a strategic initiative that we want to address, this is probably where it would go. But this forecast only uses $1.5 million for the out years of 2014-15 through 2017-18. This is the Caserta, just in a nice little graph to see it. It's going to run up on the at the last year. Another important thing that we have built into this is that 20% of our long-term obligations are covered by operating funds. And again, this is right now a strength because we have a safety net to it. If we were totally dependent upon it, it could be a negative for us. But we do have outlets for this. And it's just a good thing to show that we are a community. We are doing as much as we can to issue and take care of large capital items through operating funds. We have done that for quite some time now. This is the bottom of the projection where you can see that in dark green there the net change in fund balance. We were forecasting last year our budgeted a $400,000 loss. We actually took a $985,000 reduction on a cash basis. I think some of that will be reduced overall when we get to the modified accrual basis, but that's how it stands right now. And it's a less than 1% overall, but it's we're coming off of that to become balanced budget this year, which I'm happy we're able to do. Going forward, you can see in 2014-15, there's $361,000 of surplus, $389,000 the next year. And it starts to drop, and that's largely because of the FTE changes that we're having to add if enrollment stays the same and if we keep the same FTE ratio, which is definitely our plan to do that. So we do have some room in the next couple of years to see how things move for us and what changes, and we have a little bit of money. We also have collective bargaining agreements coming as well, though. So overall, if you look at the very bottom, right above the color key there, the legend, we're about 5.7% of reserve right now. It dips a little bit, then ends up actually back at 5.7 at the end of the 5 years. So it's relatively stable. Future threats and concerns, we just can't get away from the pension crisis. It's been, I don't know how many years. We keep wondering what's going to happen with that. But that's still out there. That's a long-term threat or even maybe short-term threat that we have to address, actually. De-annexations are something we have one in appeal right now. We have another one that may come back to us where that's a situation where we could lose some significant revenues without an equal cost reduction. And then we have expiring CBAs, collective bargaining agreements, and some other contracts. In 2013-14, this current year, our support staff and food service contracts will expire or will have to go back out. The support staff will be negotiating this year. And then in 2015-16, our faculty CBA expires. And we will also more than likely have to go back out for transportation services. You can only extend it. Really go for a maximum of 5 years under transportation contract. And if, as long as any competitor asks you to rebid it, we would have to rebid it, and we would expect some competitor to ask us to rebid it. And then the other piece, really, that's, I would call it more of a concern or just something for us that we keep on the table and, you know, are very conscious of, are new programs or service levels. Certainly those potentially driven by the strategic plan. And also, well, not the least of which might be a one-on-one type of technology initiative, which could be very expensive. And that's not in this projection. And then anything else mandated by ISBE, which we just never know what that will be. So that was the main presentation. There's a pointer for any questions that the board might have. And if not, we can go to the hearing.
I just had one question way back, and I'm sorry, I should have called you this afternoon. The revenue or the salary
alignment?
Alignment, right, and the one that showed a big spike in the salaries. Right there. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to remember why that was a new contract.
11-12, I think those were new
contracts.
Additions
to the staff?
Because, part of it might have been the support staff contract, which would have pushed that up a little bit, but we did add new staff. And when you're...
I know it looks bigger than it really is.
Yeah, and when it's... some of that is retirements from the prior year.
Okay.
And actually the... If you look at this, these are percentage changes from year to year. The year before, it dropped pretty hard.
Right.
It's coming off of a relatively low year.
I did notice that.
I think 2011-12 were primarily retirement incentives and other pieces.
Got it. Mm-hmm. And I knew that dip was that terrible year.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions? All right, let me get back to where we were. As far as the tentative budget, it was approved at the July 15th meeting. It's been on display more than 30 days. Her hearing was advertised in local papers for tonight. So at this point, I would ask the board to, now, if you don't mind, ask for a vote and approve opening of the hearing for community input.
I'll declare, as Vice President, the public hearing is open for comment. Anybody like to make comment?
Okay.
I declare the public hearing closed. Could I have a motion to adopt the budget?
So moved. I'm sorry.
What is it, Terry? I'll second it if everybody's being very quiet.
All right.
Chair Kavasich.
Aye.
Julie Beckman.
Aye.
Deb Boyle.
Aye.
Mike Davenport.
Aye.
Keith Mattoon.
Aye.
Jim Pavanato.
Aye. All right. There is no old business. And the list. Got no new business. This will be our second reception of visitors, which is intended for audience members to address the board on any issues. Anybody like to address the board? Okay. Let's go to communications and announcements. Keith, do you have anything on the report? Legislative Education Network at DuPage?
No, Lynn won't meet until the end of September.
Okay. Julia, anything to report on the School Association of Special Education?
They're meeting Wednesday, so I'll have more of a report then. But I do know that their beginning of their year has gone smoothly. They've got the staff back and all of that. And they're still in negotiations with their certified staff.
Do we have a report on the Illinois Humanities Council?
We're meeting in September as well, but I would just encourage you all to go to the Illinois Humanities Council website. It's an array of wonderful programs that the council does raise money for throughout the state. They're really amazing programs. I've sent a couple of them recommendations for them to our social studies directors because they're great things for staff and students to get involved in. But there's just all kinds of things that they do on a very limited budget, I might say.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Report on the Education Foundation, Terry?
We did meet.
There is
that?
Something coming up.
There
I
is
got
something.
An email on it.
Yes, yes. We are working on the Pizza Wars right now, which is going to be in January. And each one of us took a pizza parlor to chat with and see if they would like to participate in the Pizza
now,
Wars.
No, I thought I had an email about August 23rd. Is there a fundraiser? At the Moose?
That's the parent club.
That's the parent club.
That's
for
North High.
Okay, for North High.
Yeah, that's
okay.
Right. I'm sorry, that's
unusual,
not
too.
But I would encourage you to go.
Yes.
Every book in a calendar. Because that is for scholarships for students at North through the parent club. So, but that is not the foundation. So.
All right. Anything else to bring up?
IASB. Even though it's not until October, just get your calendars ready because there'll be a division meeting that's coming up in October. In fact, I believe it's going to be October 29th. Joanne, did you send something out on that already, or was it just that it came from?
Just to save the date.
I thought so. I thought so, but I got one from IASB too. So just mark your calendars for that, for the fall division dinner meeting, which is going to be in Bensonville. And for the audience members that are listening, our division dinner meetings are rather nice. They represent a chance to learn more about, you know, hot topics in school governance and administration, and in some divisions about the biggest legislative developments that are affecting public education. So when we do go, we take away a lot. So it's a good thing to go and learn about what's happening in our own division and in the state. So thanks.
Okay, you bet. Is there anything else to bring up or any other comments or suggestions?
I just have a rather sad announcement for those people who know Bruce and Mickey Beckman. He was a former board president, and his wife, Mickey, just passed away this weekend on Saturday after a very long, long struggle with cancer. So please keep them in your thoughts and prayers.
Okay.
Yeah, it is. It was
anything
very
else?
Sad.
Okay, our next board meeting will be September 9, 2013, 6:30 p.m. at the Administrative Service Center. And then on September 16, 2013, we have our regular business meeting. I also would like to ask all board members to stay after the meeting to sign the budget with your signature. And could I have a motion to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
All those in favor?
Second. I'll second it.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right.
Congratulations.
Over.